Let's see how to set up a full-stack web development environment for PHP using Docker. I'll be using Windows 11 as my host operating system, and Docker Desktop is already running, but I don't have any running containers yet. Let's switch to Visual Studio Code, and we'll start by running a PHP container. To make things simpler, I'll be using the Apache web server, and we can get both PHP and Apache in one container by using the Apache tag on the PHP image. So let's docker run, and I'll use the -d flag for detached, so that the container will run in the background, then the -p flag to map a port from our host to a port in the container. I'll map port 80 on my host to port 80 on the container, which is the port Apache uses for HTTP by default. Let's name our container. I'll call it phpcon for container. And the image, as we said, is going to be PHP Apache. And we now have our Apache container running with PHP support. If we now visit port 80 on our host, which is mapped to port 80 in the container, we get a reply from Apache that's running in the container. The thing is that Apache has no files to serve, so we get 403 forbidden. So let's create a file in the container so that Apache will have something to serve. To do that, we can log into our container, which can be done with a docker exec command, and we need the -it flags to get the interactive shell, and the program we want to run is bash, which can be found in the bin folder. And we logged into the container. Let's update the package list. And now that it's updated, let's install Nano, which is a minimalistic text editor for Linux. We're already in the var.html folder, which is the folder served by Apache, so let's use Nano to create a new index.php file in this folder. And I'll simply add a call to phpinfo. And when we refresh our web page, we can see that our index.php file is served back. So we can use this approach to create our PHP files and test them. But the problem is that our container is not persistent. If we were to stop our container and restart it, all of the files we created would be wiped out. That's because Docker containers are designed to be ephemeral. Out of the box, they are not persistent. In most cases, for a prolonged development session, we want our files to be persistent. In such cases, we can use a volume. This is a folder on the host that we map to the container, thus using persistent data. Let's create the folder on our host. And in this folder, I'll create my PHP file. This is a simple file that extracts a GET parameter from the URL and shows it in a paragraph. Let's see how to map this folder to our container. First, let's exit from the running container back to Windows. And if we list our containers, we can see it as the only entry in the list. Let's stop it, and we can use its name to do that. And since I want to create a new container with the same name, we need to completely remove the one we created before. To do that, we can use the container prune command, which removes all of the stopped containers. Let's now rerun the command we used to start our container. But this time, we're going to attach the volume. To do that, we use the -v flag, and we need to specify the folder in our host. So let's copy the folder's path, and we need to replace the backslashes with forward slashes, and then we need to specify the folder that we map the volume to. That's the path in the container's file system, and for an Apache container, we'll use var.html. Now, the files in the folder in our host can be served by Apache. So if we try to access disp message, we can see that we get a response. Let's try to give a value to the message get parameter, and we see the value of the parameter in a paragraph. So we have a working PHP setup. Let's see how we can add MySQL. We need to run a MySQL container, and once again, we'll run as detached, so it will run in the background, and we're also going to use a volume for this container, so that our database will be persistent. I'll create a folder on my host, let's call it DB, and let's map this folder to var lib MySQL. Let's name our container, I'll call it MySQL con, and we also need to define an environment variable for this container, MySQL root password. And this is where we define the password to the MySQL root user. I'll go with pw, and our container was created. To access the MySQL server from another container, we can find the IP address of this container. We can do that with the inspect command. So the container we want to inspect is MySQL con, and since the output of the inspect command is quite long, we can use findstr to filter it and only show lines that contain the string IP address. Notice that it is case sensitive, so capitalization matters. And we can see the IP address of our MySQL container. Let's now create a PHPMyAdmin container. PHPMyAdmin is a GUI tool for MySQL database management, and it makes creating and modifying MySQL databases a bit more intuitive. Once again, we use the detached flag and name our container. For the PHPMyAdmin container, we also need an environment variable called PMAHost, where we specify the IP address of the MySQL server. We need to use port forwarding again, and we'll map port 8080 from our host to port 80 on the container. And the PHPMyAdmin container is running. We can now visit port 8080, and we get the PHPMyAdmin login page. For username, I'll use root, and as you might remember, for the root user, we set the password pw. And we're now connected to our MySQL server. Let's create a new database. I'll call it ExampleDB. And let's create a table in this database. I'll just call it ExampleTable. And I want three columns in this table. Let's create an ID column, which will auto-increment and will be the primary key, and the other two columns will be first name and last name. So the table was created and now appears in the side menu. And if we click on it, we can see its rows, but as it was just created, it's empty, of course. Let's create a new file in our PHP working folder. And this file will insert rows of data into our table. Here is the PHP code, and as you can see, we define variables for the server name, the username, the password, and the database name. Then we use MySQL I to connect to the server. Once that's done, we run the insert into query to create two new rows, one for John Doe, another for Jane Doe. Let's try to open this file in our web browser. And we get fatal error, and that's because we don't have the MySQL I PHP extension installed. MySQL I is the PHP extension for MySQL, and it's not included in the PHP Docker image. We could, of course, log into our container and install this extension, but in my opinion, this is not the best solution. Everything we install locally in a container is temporary. And if we were to restart the container, we would have to install the MySQL I extension again. So what I'm going to do instead is create a Docker file. Here, we first define the base image, which is PHP Apache. Then we use the run command to install the MySQL I extension. And we also need to expose port 80. We can now create a new image that's based on this Dockerfile, and containers from this image will have the MySQL I extension. So let's stop and remove our PHP container. And now let's use build to create the image. I'll call it Apache MySQL I. And we need to specify the folder for the Docker file, which is the current folder, which we indicate with a dot. And the image was created. And if we list our Docker images, we can see our new Apache MySQL I image among them. Now we can create our PHP container using this image. And since we use a volume, the PHP files will be accessible right away. So let's refresh our page. And this time, since we have MySQL I installed, we can see that the new records were created. If we now get back to PHPMyAdmin and click on our table again, we can see that it now contains two rows, one for John Doe, another for Jane Doe. One last thing I want to mention is how we can streamline this whole process using docker-compose. Let's create docker-compose.yml and let me paste the content. And let's go over it real quick. So every container that is defined in a docker-compose file is referred to as a service. Our first service is apache-php. For this service, we specify the image, which is the image we defined in the Dockerfile. Then, since this is an image that can be built locally, we specify the path to the Dockerfile. That's the same folder in my case. And this way, our image will be rebuilt if we change its configuration down the line. We then specify the volume for this container and the port to be forwarded. Lastly, we define a network that this container will belong to. Having containers share a network allows us to access another container using its service name. We then configure the MySQL container. And this one is going to be based on the MySQL image, and it's going to belong to the same network. And finally, we have our PHPMyAdmin container. And notice how I use MySQL as the host for PHPMyAdmin. I can do that because the MySQL and the PHPMyAdmin services share a network. And finally, under Networks, we define our app network. Let's use Docker Desktop to delete all of the currently running containers. And we can simply run docker-compose app to start everything. We use the -d flag to start the containers in the background, and we can see that our network was created and all of the containers were started. And we can test, for example, our disp message file, and we get the expected result.